in on a donkey and a colt. I always thought that was interesting. I'm not sure how that worked. But it says he rode them both in. Maybe he had his feet on the wheel. Anyway, Matthew also says that most of the people coming in, most of the crowd that went before Jesus, were shouting, Hosanna. But you know, then it makes you kind of wonder what the rest of the folks were doing. And there were bound to be others, right? We know how parades work. There's always those people who get up early and they get their blanket and the picnic basket and the thermos full of coffee and they go and they get their place on the curb, right? So they know where they're going to be when the parade comes. And then there's all the people just kind of going by. They didn't know the parade was even happening and they stand off to the side. They watch what's going on. They don't get involved too much, kind of like people who walk by somebody fighting without trying to stop it, or kind of people that just sort of walk through life and don't get particularly involved. The polls tell us that about 85% of Americans will claim that they believe in Jesus and will claim Christianity as their religion, even though a lot of them have never been in a church and never been particularly interested in doing the things that Jesus asks us to do, like feeding the hungry and clothing the poor and visiting the sick, praying for our enemies, taking care of a stranger. So anyway, those onlookers must have been some of those other people there that day. Surely there were a number of people who were there to make sure things didn't get out of hand, right? You know how parades can be. And there must have been some people who had the authority and the responsibility for public safety, right? Made sure the permits were bought and fees were paid. And I'm sure in Jerusalem that day there were soldiers that were stationed around the gates of the city to make sure that nothing became too dangerous or controversial or too strange. Soldiers were always curious as to what any group of about, you know, more than three were doing. I'm sure they were concerned about what Reinhard Niebuhr said, that many of us might be really good citizens by ourselves, but under pressure of five or six, we can become violent and dangerous. Moral man in moral society. So certainly there were those there that day that were there to keep peace, right? To maintain order and preserve the status quo. But most of the crowd, Matthew says, most of the crowd were running around shouting Hosanna, waving palms. And they were the followers and disciples of Jesus. And the ones who were there were excited about what they knew was happening that day, right? They were the disciples who had become so caught up in the words and hopes of Jesus that they had left their homes and their families, their nets, their ships, their boats, their livelihoods behind to follow Jesus. They slept on the ground. They almost drowned in midnight storms on the sea. They saw miracles and they saw things that made them doubt everything they thought about life and about God. So now they were coming to celebrate that the kingdom of God was at hand, right? They were welcoming this revolution they knew was going to take place. They were sure that Jesus was there to throw out the Romans and put them back in their rightful places. And the incredible thing is about all of these people, whether they just came as spectators or came because they thought they could, you know, keep the calm and keep the status quo, keep things going as they should, or whether they were there celebrating the coming of the king, they were all wrong. They were all wrong, right? Jesus came in Jerusalem for all of them, but they were all wrong. These gawkers, the rubberneckers, the looky-loos, you know, they thought Jesus was just a prophet. And the authorities thought they might have power to control what was going on, to stop the revolution that was coming. And the disciples, they were not ready at all for the kind of kingdom of God that was, in fact, getting ready to begin. Jesus came into Jerusalem to save and redeem them all, and they were all wrong about who he was and what he was doing. And the thing is that Jesus keeps riding into our midst, right, with that same desire to redeem all of us. And he keeps getting this bunch of people standing around claiming to be Christians, hanging out on the sidelines, you know, refusing to get involved. And there are still people in positions of authority, we're very aware of them right now, who want to exercise their power and believe that they have the answers, right? And that somehow having power makes them bearers of the truth. There was a big church dinner, and the governor who was running for re-election was going to be a speaker at the church that night. And he got there a little late, so when he went through the line to get his dinner, he was handed a plate from a lady named Lucille, who gave him one piece of chicken, like she'd been doing for everybody. And the governor asked for a second piece, and she said, no. And the governor said, well, maybe you don't know who I am. I'm the governor of Texas. I've been out campaigning all day. I'm tired. I'm hungry. I have to speak in a little while. You know, couldn't I please have a second piece? And Lucille said, I'm sorry, but maybe you don't know who I am. I am Lucille, the woman in charge of giving out chicken. And you only get one piece. People in authority. Do what they want to do with no regard for others. I don't know who's at fault in that one. It seems like Lucille could have given him a second piece of chicken. Just saying. So these sidewalk gawkers, the people who want to keep things under control, and you and I, we'll all be there when that next parade comes by. We who want to be the disciples of Jesus, you know, and wave the palm branches. We go to church, we feed the hungry, we read our Bibles, we take our classes. We do the fun things, we have Mardi Gras and egg hunts. And, you know, we try to keep an open mind, open hearts, open doors, trying to live into this understanding that we have of who the Messiah is, of who this Jesus is. And we want to be faithful, right? We want to be faithful to him and to all of our brothers and sisters in Christ and all of our brothers and sisters who still need a word of hope, right? But we're always getting it wrong. We keep twisting things and we misapply things and we use the Bible as a weapon instead of a greeting of goodwill, and we judge each other and we hoard our blessings. We make each other wrong so that we can appear right. We keep our buildings and our lives and our hearts neat and tidy and fortified by walls to keep. And yet Jesus just keeps riding in for us all, right? All of us. Jesus rides in and keeps coming back for us, keeps coming by the lakeshore and inviting us into service. Jesus keeps coming back, assuring us that, yeah, you know what, you're close, but you don't have it all right. Jesus rides in with this desire to bring redemption to us all. And he keeps coming back over and over and over in one way or another, telling us not to be afraid, telling us to be courageous and loving and kind. And he comes to offer us the gift of this kingdom that is completely different from anything we have, and even from what most of us could hope for or even imagine. But Jesus is present. He was present that day. He's still present today. And today is a celebration of that constant coming. There is a very hard week ahead of us. It was a horrible, heartbreaking week for Jesus. And it's difficult for us as we remember it and all that it means. Here comes Holy Week, Steve Barnes Holmes writes. When we look straight at our evil, our violence, our injustice, and blame it on God, saying Jesus had to die. Which is what we always say of whomever we're making suffer at the moment, right? Whether it's prisoners or immigrants or Native people, people of color, LGBT folks, the poor, and on and on and on, including the earth itself. It's just the way it is, we tell ourselves. And then God steps right into the middle of our lies and our complacency and our cold-heartedness, and he says, no, that's not the way it is. It's not the way it ever was or ever will be. The way is life and love. That's the way. And all week long, we choose to not believe that, right? And then finally on Easter, it sinks in. And this whole story is about us coming to and coming around to the truth of who Jesus is. So in he rides for us all. And blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.